So far, there's still something going on for us.
Yeah.
What I should do is... Yep. That's not what she said at all.
You know, I think about, like, this kind of beach is any fun. My sister.
Do I have to have a bridge?
Yeah. It's like about the school drugs. Sometimes it's collecting school supplies so that I can hand them out. My parents don't have a letter about it.
I know, nice. You just get it and that.
Hey, Maggie, go get me a bulletin. Well, I don't have it. Oh.
Everybody doing all right here?
Yeah, we're all right.
All right. How's the new house? Good? Different?
The cat hasn't peed anymore, and I think that
might be. The cats like it, is what she's saying.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going good.
A few months from now, you'll get everything all settled down.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be nice.
Yeah.
It'll be nice.
Oh, we got a watcher.
Hello. Today, A given.
No, G-con.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Hey, Dustin.
Hi.
Good to see you. How you feeling?
Not bad.
So, Jackson came back with a 6mm, and they just have to monitor it once a year.
Good.
The breathing problem was due to obstruction in his airway.
Okay.
So, that's been fixed this week.
Awesome.
So, I just want to know. Both of them pray.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear it's just a monitoring.
Yeah.
That's great. That's not too bad.
I'm just gonna watch him.
Every year. Want to see you? Good.
Yeah.
That's good.
That is good.
He has any sense. Because
so that when the choir sings, everybody can hear it.
Yeah.
And not just the people.
See, there's Mandy.
That's Mandy.
She'll be doing children's church. Misty this morning?
Yes.
I'm trying to finish getting this.
It's all good. And not, if you knock this over, you're going to be in trouble, baby boy. Any noise you make, you might come through. Any noise you make, you come through. I've never been picked so yep.
Notice the prayer list and the weekly calendar and the announcements in your bulletin. If you have any concerns or praises, please list those on the prayer request forms in your pew and put those in the offering plate. Missions will meet tomorrow at 3:15 at Pleasant View. Finance will meet tomorrow at 4 here at the church. There will be a meal and activities on Wednesday. August 1st, the college summer prayer list will be cleared. So if you know people who are going to college tech school in the fall, give us their names, mailing addresses, email addresses. We'll start that list shortly after that so that we can send them the bridge, give them gifts, pray for them. August 4th will be the back to school blessing for those in pre-K through college and tech school and any educators or educational support staff that we have that Sunday. Bible schools, 29th and 31st this month. Their registration forms will be back on the table in Center Street. Need to get those in as quickly as possible. We could still use some workers. There's a form in the hallway behind the organ where you can sign up to work. We could use some people to help take kids home at the end of the day. Even if you could volunteer for one day, that would be helpful. You let me know. Next Sunday is the last day for our school supply collection. And if you forget, your checks are okay. And then notice again in the announcements, in the bulletin about the Hamel Free Clinic and the blessing box there. Are there any other announcements that anyone knows of? If you will stand now and sing one verse of our fellowship song and then greet those around you.
Good morning. Good morning. next Easter. I'm not going to fail me, I'm not telling you. Morning, young man. How are you this morning?
How are you?
Peace be with you.
Good morning.
Thank you. He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. He's coming back again.
Let our faith be more than anthems.
Greater than the songs we sing.
In our weakness and temptations,
we believe.
Let the lost be found, let the dead be raised.
In the here and now, let love invade. Let the church live loud, our God will save.
The gates of hell will not prevail.
For the power of God has torn the veil. We know your love will never fail. We believe.
Very handy. The nice thing about it is it helps us to measure lots of different things. Okay.
I'll just do this one. Thank you. Okay, well, anyway, we use this to measure things. The story that we're going to talk about in Luke 19 today is about a man by the name of Zacchaeus, and he has been measure. Because the story tells us that, first of all, he's short.
He is short, and he is just a kind of guy who has a hard time getting along because the job that he has, well, he's taken advantage of a lot of people. What's that? There is a song about it, and it's a good song, too. Yeah, and that song tells us that he was a short little man, and one day he wanted... That's right. And one day he wanted to see Jesus, so what did he do? Yeah, he couldn't see over the people, but he saw a tree. And he decided, I'll climb this tree. And then when I sit in that tree, I'll be able to see Jesus, and that would be enough. Well, anyway, when Jesus came to him, he got a big surprise. He didn't come up to him and say, hey, you short little man, what are you doing up there? I've heard about you, you're a bad person. No, Jesus came to him and first of all called him by his name. He said, Zacchaeus, you come down from that tree. Because I'm going to your house and I'm going to have dinner with you. And everybody around him was just amazed at this meaning because they thought Jesus was going to give him a really hard time because he didn't have a very good reputation among the people. But Zacchaeus took him home to his house. And as a result of being with Jesus, he became a believer and it changed his life. And he decided that he needed to fix some things in his life. All the money that he had taken from people in a wrong way, he took and he gave it back to them. And even in fact, some people he had cheated, he gave them back four times as much. You know what? We tend to measure people. We measure them sometimes by how smart they are, or what kind of clothes they wear, or how tall they are, or how cool they are, or what group of friends they are. The nice thing about this story about Zacchaeus, Jesus looked at him and said, I like you, Zacchaeus, but I want you to be better. And that's the neat thing about loving God, is he loves us just the way that we are. So let's say our prayer, and then at the end of our prayer, let's say the Lord's Prayer together, okay? Dear God, thank you for the love that we find in your Son, Jesus Christ. And we love you, and we want to serve you. Please help us to be very open and loving to all the people of this world, just as you are. Because in doing that, we honor you and obey you. And now, we all pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to this offering time, you'll notice that there are sitting on the end of the pews, there is a blue registry. If you would sign your name and pass that down, we would love to have a record of your attendance here today. It is something that we enjoy doing. And then as we come to this time of offering, I'd like to remind you of these words of Scripture. Luke chapter 6, verse 38, Jesus says, give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, it will be poured into your lap. For with the measure that you use, it will be measured to you. Let us give. Thank you.
So we give you this offering today, and with it we worship you and give our whole selves to you. Take it now, use it for your kingdom and your glory, extend and multiply its reach and influence. May it be a great blessing to many. And this we ask in the powerful name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
I would ask you to join us singing these words as we go into the proclamation of the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. We will read verses 1 through 10. Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. A pastor phoned the home of a family who had recently visited his church. And a voice on the other end of the phone answered with a whispered, and the pastor asked, "Who is this?" The whispered voice said, "Jimmy." The pastor asked, "Well, how old are you, Jimmy?" "I'm 4. Well then, Jimmy, may I please speak to your mom?" "No, she's busy." "May I speak to your dad?" "No, he's busy too." "Well, are there any other adults in your home?" "The police." "Then may I speak to one of the police officers?" "No, he's busy." "Who else is there?" "A fireman." "May I speak to one of the firemen?" "No, they're busy too." "Jimmy, I'm a little concerned and a little worried. Is everything okay? What are all of these people so busy doing?" "They're looking for me." Luke 19, there is a story about someone being found. It's a familiar story. Verse 1, he entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him because he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back 4 times as much." And then Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house because he is too a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." This is a word from the Lord. Thanks be to God. Yeah, the story of Zacchaeus is just one of those biblical stories that many of us have heard since childhood. In fact, we may be so familiar with it or think that we are that we miss some of the simple truth in the story. You see, there's one word that I can't help but notice in Luke that he focuses on in both chapters 18, the chapter just before this one, and chapter 19. It's the word rich. In Luke 18, he describes Jesus' encounter with a rich young ruler. And as the story goes, he walks away of his own choice, much poorer because he can't seem to follow Jesus in the way that he asked him. But now, here in Luke 19, he puts a focus on a man who is described as short, but after his encounter with Jesus, he walks away like a giant. And in both cases, each story has to do with how they handle the wealth and giving Jesus a place in their lives. Now, the interesting thing about Zacchaeus is that he could afford and possess most anything he wanted. But the number one extravagance in his life was the one thing that he did not want: loneliness. He was bankrupt in loneliness, but in meeting Jesus, he would experience the extravagance of mercy and grace. Now let's just start with his name, Zacchaeus. It's a noble, thoroughly Jewish name. It means righteous one. Yeah, that's where the irony kind of kicks in. A tax collector named Righteous. For a Jew to be a tax collector made him both thief and traitor. He was a thief because he had unregulated power to charge people anything he wanted. And anything above what Rome meted as a tax, he pocketed. That's how he got so wealthy. He was a traitor because he was a Jew. He was a son of Abraham working for dominion for Rome. And now, put those two things together and you can kind of begin to understand why he was so very, very lonely. Luke described that he was not only a tax collector, but a chief tax collector. Not just a chief tax collector, he was rich. Now, wealth in and of itself, it's not wrong. But in both stories, chapter 18, chapter 19, it seems that both men had made a decision to make wealth their number one priority. Money, possessions, financial power, these were the antidote for their debt of character. Their wealth ambitions, that was the aspirin that they swallowed every day to chase away the hangover of emptiness. And rich is a word not secondary to Luke. In the story of Jesus' encounter with the rich young ruler, Luke quotes Jesus. Jesus concludes his meeting with the rich young ruler by saying how hard it is for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And then he even takes it a step further and he gives him a little bit of a picture. He said, you know what? It's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than it is for a person whose life and focus and ambition is their personal wealth instead of living in the richness of God's kingdom. So as Zacchaeus steps up the bat, he's already in the hole. He's got two strikes against him. He's a tax collector, and he's rich. Now, the beauty of this story for me is the catawampus way of leading us to truth. Catawampus. That's that word my dad used to use all the time. It meant it didn't look right. It was uneven. It wasn't in quiet order. It's not what you expect. Catawampus. Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming to Jericho, so he went to find Jesus. What he got was a catawampus surprise of God's mercy. He thought he was on a mission to find Jesus, only to discover that Jesus was already on a mission to find him. And that's the surprise of God's mercy, the miracle of divine grace. Before we go searching for God, God is already in search of us. Now Zacchaeus went to see Jesus. And the crowd was so big that they were blocking his view of the road, so what's he to do? Well, he fights back the inclination to just give up and go home, retreat. Takes on the attitude of a child. He sees a sycamore tree and he says, you know what? If I can get up in that tree, then I can see Jesus. He unwittingly does this, not realizing that he is about ready to find the answer to his loneliness. His answer, it came in Jesus, who upon seeing Zacchaeus in the tree, walks over to him, calls him by his name and says, Zacchaeus, come down from that tree. I'm going to go to your house for the rest of the day. The catawampus divine initiative. Zacchaeus went to find Jesus. Jesus was already in search of Zacchaeus. Now, isn't that the way God is? I mean, have you ever been in Zacchaeus' shoes? You finally decide to do something about your life, to change some things. And you discover that the real reason for the motivation within you to change is due to the fact that God's already been at work in you. You may have even given up on God, never even given God a chance, but God has never ever given up on you. In fact, God has been around all the while, searching and prompting and patiently waiting. It is at this moment that salvation dawns on Zacchaeus. When Jesus called him by his name, when he stuck up his hand and invited himself home for dinner, that is how the salvation of God in Christ begins, in the glad welcome of God. Now, wouldn't we have all liked to have seen the expression on Zacchaeus' face when Jesus walked up and invited himself home to his house? Frederick Beekman, one of my favorite authors, says, it's not important how Zacchaeus got out of the sycamore, but chances are good he fell out of pure astonishment. You see, in those days, to go home with someone and share a meal, that was a reservation for a very cherished, intimate conversation. The best of friends. Jesus didn't come to Zacchaeus saying, sinner, man, I've got a big beef with you and how you live your life. Get down out of that tree. No, it was more like, friend, let's go to lunch. That's how salvation comes to us. God moves near in Jesus and extends his welcoming arms. No matter who you are or what you've done, God welcomes us. And he keeps coming. He keeps extending those arms until we decide it is God's salvation that we want and need, and it's the only thing that really counts. Now, enter the grumblers. This is the dark side of the story. While one person's being saved, others are growing angry, and they begin their plots to kill Jesus. How can this Jesus be so free and gracious with God's love? When Jesus walked up to Zacchaeus, I mean, the crowd leaned in anticipation. They were just waiting for Jesus to open up a big old jar of hellfire and damnation and give it to him. Oh, woe to you. Repent. Shape up or else. And you could almost kind of hear them saying, all right, Jesus, give it to him. But once again, the non-expected moment takes place when what they heard Jesus saying was, hey, Zacchaeus, hurry down from that tree. I'm staying with you today. And you could have heard a sycamore fig hit the ground. Eventually, the silence is replaced with murmuring and grumbling, and then comes that great line, oh, he's gone home to be with a sinner, as if everyone else is not in that category. Now, if you think about it, the response is kind of like Jonah seeing Nineveh at the end of the story being spared. Or kind of like the older brother watching his no-account brother, you know, daddy's prodigal boy who gets a homecoming feast. Or like the Pharisees of all ages, like the ones in the Bible, the ones we know today, who claim God's love for themselves, but yet they limit it to others. You see, the fine citizens of Jericho were not one bit happy with Jesus. The thought of it, Jesus inviting himself as a guest of Zacchaeus, that traitor, that thief, that chief of sinners. So the crowd leaves grumbling and plotting, and off go Zacchaeus and Jesus. They have dinner, like two best friends. Interesting. One just down from a tree, and the other soon to be nailed to a tree. And there, at Zacchaeus' house, salvation was completed. You see, salvation always begins with God's first move, but it must end in human response. And the response has concrete, life-altering consequences. For Zacchaeus, it was repentance in the strictest sense of the word. It was a 180-degree about-face. It was repentance of both mind and heart. And in verse 8, he said, look, Lord, half of all I have I will give to the poor, and for everybody that I've cheated, I'll pay back 400%. Stephen Shoemaker says, salvation moves from the arithmetic of the law to the extravagance of grace. Because see, the Old Testament law said that the most you need to give to the poor, 20%. Zacchaeus gave 50. And the law said all you need to do to pay back someone that you cheated is the principal amount plus 20%. Zacchaeus gave 400%. Now, if there was ever such a thing as a new creation, here it was in the flesh in this new Zacchaeus. Walter Rauschenbusch was an American theologian and a Baptist pastor back in the late 19th and early 20th century. And he gets to this point in the story in a sermon. He said, this is where the camel passed through the eye of the needle, and Jesus stood and cheered. Today, Jesus says, salvation has come to this house. The salvation that began in heaven was finally completed on earth, and what began in the heart of God, it reached into the bank account of Zacchaeus. What began as an initiative of grace ended with repentance in Zacchaeus. And isn't that how God's salvation in Christ appears and operates? It doesn't require prior repentance, because then it wouldn't be grace. But it comes bringing repentance and its wings. And in God's gospel, welcome precedes worthiness. Acceptance comes before change. Zacchaeus received the salvation of God, and this salvation, it worked a change in him. Repentance. Now, there is a time-sensitive feature to this story. Today, Jesus said, I must go to your house. Today, salvation has come to this house. Today is the tense of salvation, and it's also its urgency. Today, I must go to your house. If salvation is available now, what could be more important? And salvation comes to us. The gospel of Christ celebrates the present tense of salvation. Today, now, this moment, the kingdom draws near. God's saving power is available to all of us in whatever ways we most need it. Maybe we need the power to forgive. Maybe we need sustained power just to get through some very challenging times. Maybe the power is to let go of that which enslaves us. Or the power just to ward off temptation that is so strong we have a tough time doing it. Or maybe it comes in just a simple step of faith, the power to believe. God's salvation even now draws near. How is God wishing to change you this day? Don't let the particulars of Zacchaeus' conversion put you off. Salvation is not legalism. It is a life in and with the Spirit of God. It's not a matter of what you have to do. It's a matter of what you offer to God in response to accepting His love. Just take, for example, the contrast between Zacchaeus again and that rich young ruler. Jesus demanded that the rich young ruler sell all that he had and give it to the poor. Zacchaeus got off with just giving away half. I mean, did the rich young ruler get a bad deal? Why the inconsistency? Well, that inconsistency is just the marked difference between a life under law and a life under grace. You see, the rich young ruler came and said, what do I have to do? What do I have to give up to be saved? That's the voice of law. Jesus said to him, well, you've got to give it all. Zacchaeus said in response to Jesus, Lord, here's half of what I have. I offer it to you in the kingdom. That's the voice of grace That voice has been touched by grace. And Jesus stood and cheered, "Zacchaeus, salvation has come to you today." There is only one power in the universe that can liberate us from the power of sin, and that's Jesus. And he comes to find us and to forgive us and to set us free, just like he did with Zacchaeus. Let's pray. Almighty and gracious God, your Son Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Come now to us in our lostness, our loneliness, our sin, our sickness, that we may be found by you. Then we will turn to you and to our neighbor with love, and then we will know and hear salvation's bell ring out. Today, grace has come in your Son, Jesus Christ, and to that we give you great thanks. And to the praise and the glory of God, we give thanks in his name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our hymn of response is "Grace Alone." Let us stand and sing. Give you peace through his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.